When it comes to healthcare today, what's natural is that it's a deeply human personal experience. Kindness, empathy, compassion, eye contact, human touch. When we're feeling sick, when we're unwell, when we need help and reassurance, we turn to human doctors, human healthcare professionals. That's what's natural right now. However, I want to tell you a story about something that happened to me and my family, which made me rethink what's going to be natural in healthcare and whether humans will always be at the center of the healthcare experience. So, last year in England, my mother called a service on the telephone provided by the healthcare system where you can phone up, you describe your symptoms, and then tell you whether to go to the emergency room, whether you go to urgent care, or whether it's something you can take care of at home, using over-the-counter medicines, for example. So, middle of the night, and she called up, and they took her through the list of questions, and they were rushing her through the list of questions. She's in her 70s, she's sick, she's confused, it's the middle of the night. And she was telling them, look, I'm really old, I need time to think about my answers, and they were rushing her and rushing her. And she felt that the entire experience, despite a human being a human being on the end of the telephone in the healthcare system, it was missing of compassion, empathy, kindness. Now, contrast that with a few weeks later, I was also unwell, and I decided to use the same service, but this time there's a version of that telephone hotline, but provided via an app, without any human being. And I put in my symptoms, and the end result was, it advised me I can take care of myself at home, nothing to worry about, you don't need to go to a facility. But what I found was really interesting was compared to my mother's experience of the human being on the telephone rushing her through the questions is this machine using this app, I had time to think about my answers. I had time to respond. I wasn't rushed. And it really felt like a compassionate experience. And it made me think, are we at a point where one day we might have machines that can care for us, machines that can do what humans currently do today. And when we think about the greater challenge, we currently have 7.5 billion people on this planet. Many of them don't have access to any healthcare facilities, and even if they do have access, it's often unaffordable, or there's long queues. And if you think by the end of this century, it's forecast that we're going to go from 7.5 billion to 11 billion people. How are we going to provide safe and affordable healthcare to those 11 billion people by the end of this century? And then on top of that, there's another trend that healthcare systems are trying to reposition themselves and saying, instead of just coming to us when you're sick, what can we do to help you prevent you from getting a disease? How can we help you stay healthy? So self-care and taking more responsibility for our own health on a daily basis. And that's where AI is coming in, artificial intelligence. So you'll hear stories, influential people saying, we've got to be really scared about AI, because if it develops and we let it develop, it's going to end up ruling us and we're going to become slaves to these machines. But I believe, especially in healthcare, what if we can develop AI that's compassionate, that's kind, that's empathetic, and it can fill this gap in helping 11 billion people in the future at the end of this century have access to healthcare whenever they want it at the right time. And I want to share my experience. I've been trying a number of chatbots. You may have tried chatbots for customer service on a website. And this one's called BySir. It's developed in India, a compassionate AI chatbot. And what I found when I was using it is that it actually feels like you're talking or you're chatting to a real human being. And the founder of this chatbot, BySir, is a lady called Jo Agarwal, based out in India. And in her TEDx talk last year, she talked about what changed for her, that after some users had been using this, she got a message from one of the users, a 13-year-old girl, who said that she had suicidal thoughts, and what helped her cling on to life at that point was BySir, this app on her phone. Think about it, imagine the people out there around the world. They don't feel like they have friends or family or even a psychiatrist or a psychologist to turn to. And in that moment, what if they could turn to a machine that cares. Is that a bad thing just because it's not natural? Think of how many lives could be saved when it comes to mental health. You've got the rise of smart speakers from Google, from Amazon, even from Apple now. So children now growing up, finding it perfectly normal and natural to have a conversation with a smart speaker and ask it the news, ask it the weather, possibly even get information on health. And then if you think about with the potential for this, researchers are already working on algorithms behind the scenes that will take this voice data, you're having a conversation, and it could even potentially detect conditions like Alzheimer's and Parkinson's just from your voice data. Think how powerful that could be on a global basis, just from these speakers as they evolve. It's even coming to toothbrushes. So this is me brushing my teeth in London with the world's first toothbrush, which is powered by AI. It has sensors in it, monitors my brushing frequency, my habits, how much pressure I'm putting. But what surprised me was that this toothbrush actually cares about my sleep as well. So it noticed that I was brushing my teeth consistently late at night and says, hey, maybe you want to go to bed earlier and have a good night's sleep. How would you feel about this world where even your toothbrush is now caring for you, not just about your teeth, but about your sleep? What next? It's going to tell me what pizza I should eat tomorrow? So potentially in the future, we might have machines that care for us because they can recognize and respond to our emotions in real time. This is what researchers out there are working on. They have this vision of machines that are as compassionate and kind, as empathetic as any of us as humans. So it might not feel artificial anymore to deal with a machine in these scenarios in healthcare. So there's a company out in the US, Effectiva, and they're working on emotion AI for automotive, for example. So picture this scenario. You're stuck in rush hour traffic here in Porto. You're feeling a bit sad. It's been a long day. You're stressed out. How would you feel if the car could detect that you're feeling sad from your expressions on your face and how you're looking and how you're feeling? And then maybe suggest, oh, maybe I'll play some music to cheer you up, or maybe I'll change the fresh air setting in the car. Or maybe if it can detect that you're feeling that tired, that it says, pull over at the next rest area. So think about even these cars that potentially will care for us, these machines. How do we feel about more and more machines caring for us? And it's important to understand what people want. It's not just about technology, people saying, we can develop this, let's roll this out, it's great for humanity. Let's ask people. So there was a survey done that asked people in a number of countries, how willing would you be willing to engage with AI and robotics for your healthcare needs? And they asked people in a number of countries. The country where people were most willing to engage with healthcare and robotics, with AI and robotics for their healthcare needs, was Nigeria, in Africa. 94% of people surveyed in Nigeria said, yes, I'll be willing to engage with AI. So when you think about where are the places in the world that are going to try these new advances in terms of caring machines, where is it going to hit first? Who's going to be most open to it? It could be countries we don't associate with innovation and technology. And in fact, in that same survey, in the UK, only 39% of people said they'd be willing to engage with AI and robotics for healthcare needs. And then what about when we might prefer, even if you've got a human being available in healthcare, when might you prefer a machine, to deal with a machine? So there was another survey, this one done in 2016, they asked smartphone users around the world, and they found that actually 29% of those people surveyed said for sensitive matters, they would prefer to deal with an AI medical advisor than a human being. Think about that. What could drive you to prefer a machine than a human being? I was thinking maybe it's mental health, maybe it's sexual health. How many of you have had an embarrassing condition and it's either delayed you seeking help or you haven't looked for help at all because it's just too embarrassing? You don't want another human being to judge you because you have that condition. But there are tough decisions ahead. It's not going to be easy. again, like I said, it's not a case of just this technology is here, let's use it. We have to be very, very cautious because, again, this is our health, this is our well-being. And there was a video for a robot that's come out of London. And in this video, their promotional video, it showed somebody reaching for a midnight snack. Many of us have had midnight snacks. We're not supposed to. It's bad for our health, but we do. And in this video, this robot that was in the kitchen noticed that they were reaching for the midnight snack and prompted, as they opened the door, "Hey, sure you want to have that burger or that cake? It's extra 2 hours to burn it off in the morning to go for a run." And that person then decides to follow the robot's advice and not have that midnight snack. How do you feel about a world where you'll stay healthy, you'll be prevented from having so many diseases because these machines will limit our choices on a daily basis, whether it's in the car or the office, at home, wherever we are? How do you feel about your freedom being affected there with machines that care? And then underpinning this revolution is going to be data about us, our preferences, our behaviors, our habits. And think about the recent scandal with Facebook and Cambridge Analytica, and then privacy and trust. Who's going to be having access to all this data? Is it a health insurer? Are people going to be using it to penalize us because we're making decisions that are not healthy? So there's so much to think about on this road ahead. And then errors as well. So the possibilities are that actually, if we turn to machines that care, maybe they're not going to make mistakes like human healthcare professionals do. They're not going to give us the wrong drug. They're not going to misdiagnose us. But equally, these digital assistants that are going to care for us are not perfect either. So just this week, I was trying something from Microsoft called Cortana. It's a general purpose assistant on my phone. And I said, "I'm bleeding." And it says, "Okay." I said, "I'm bleeding to death." It says, "Interesting." So we have to be really careful in this journey, who we trust, what we trust. And accountability is really important. So today, if a doctor makes a mistake, we can go there and say, "Hey, you made a mistake, you gave me the wrong medicine." Who are we going to hold accountable when these algorithms, these robots, these chatbots, these machines that care for us get something wrong? How do we even know when they've made a mistake? There's millions of lines of code. Who's going to regulate them? Another thing I was thinking about is that potentially could it make the world more unequal in terms of, could it only be in the future that the very rich people have access to human healthcare professionals? For the rest of us, we all have access to healthcare, but it's via a machine or a type of machine. Think of Japan as well. Now, in some ways, they're ahead of the curve. They've got an aging population, a shrinking workforce, and they're also leading the world when it comes to the research of care robots, especially for the elderly. And I met a lady from Japan a few years ago. She said, "I'd rather be cared for by a robot nurse than a foreign nurse." Why? Because they don't want to open themselves to immigration. So what does that mean here in Europe? You've got Brexit. Part of the driver for Brexit was immigration, a fear. We want to reduce immigration. So does that mean here in Europe we're going to end up in a world where we do have these machines that care for us because we're suddenly afraid of foreigners? We won't have enough people to care. Then what about loneliness, an epidemic of loneliness? So in the UK, it's suggested that we give these smart speakers to the elderly to combat loneliness. Is this the kind of world we want to build when we have a connection to a machine rather than each other? Is that really the way forwards? So we have to have balance. We can't be too afraid. We can't be too excited. We have to take a middle path when it comes to this future. But if done well, if we do it right, if we really involve everybody in the conversation, I believe that potentially machines that care can increase the humanity in healthcare around the world. Think about those 11 billion people by the end of this century. So at what point this century will it become natural that when we're sick, when we want health advice, we turn to a machine rather than a human being? And finally, I want to ask you, are you ready for a world where we have machines that care? Thank you.